This is ECIS Talks from the Educational Collaborative for International Schools.
Welcome to our podcast. Today, I, Sarah Kupke, Head of Professional Learning at ECIS, I'm talking to Dr. Omolola Wright Odusoga. She's a British African. She is a transformative instructional leader with more than 18 years of experience in education, leadership, and administration. She has experience in school startup, curriculum development, classroom instruction, and in-depth knowledge of educational policy, procedures, government legislation, guidelines, and accreditation standards. Dr. Omolola Wright Odusoga has worked in teaching and educational leadership roles in the UK and in the Middle East, where she was a founding head of school for two schools. She offers educational consultations to schools in Africa through her educational consultancy company, Tumi Teaching and Learning Solutions. And she mentors and coaches new and aspiring school principals. She's currently leading an international school where she's employing her pedagogical experience as a leader to ensuring that all students have access to teaching and learning amidst the global pandemic. Dr. Lola, welcome to our webinar today. I'm going to start our conversation by asking you, teach me how to say your name.
Good afternoon, morning, Sarah, where you are, should I say. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction, and thank you for having me on your podcast today. So my name is Omolola, which means child is wealth.
Beautiful. That's lovely. We've had some conversations with each other, and we've been talking about global diversity. And so I'd love you to share your thoughts on how global diversity can be reflected in education.
Yes, thank you. I mean, that's a very insightful question, Sarah. Thank you. I think for global diversity to adequately reflect in education in today's fast-paced world, both in teaching and its application, I think educators will need to develop a genuine appreciation of the complex and unique ways different groups perceive education itself. And I think naturally, this will of necessity be linked to beliefs, culture, upbringing, and social backgrounds. And additionally, we must note the fact that the world is currently experiencing a very significant paradigm shift in education. We have online instructions these days, we have blended learning, and which is the most notable paradigm shift in education in recent times. It is potentially impacting any set of cultural assumption we may have anywhere in the world. And the pertinent question is online education sufficiently culturally responsive? If it is not, what can we as educators do to enhance its effectiveness within the context of global cultural diversity? And perhaps the most effective way to promote global diversity in education would be to encourage schools from diverse regions of the world to connect in such a way that can share both knowledge and best practices in teaching methods. I would think a starting point or an example could be school librarians. You know, they could be the key stakeholders in such global schemes by connecting and collaborating with other librarians instructively along this line of thinking.
That's so interesting to hear, because of this complex, you talk about this the complex ways that we perceive education within our various different social settings, and that paradigm shift across the world. I think our librarians conference at ECIS is one of our best attended, well, several of them are, but it's an extremely well attended conference, and it's lovely to hear you pulling them in as the sort of the core of where that communication, that hub of communication within our schools. Thank you. So what can the global community do to help build an understanding of global diversity? You mentioned the librarians and their role that they play within our school settings. What are your thoughts about how that happens globally, perhaps within international school education in particular?
Thank you. I think we need, first of all, we need to properly capture the meaning and the essence of the term global diversity. Global diversity refers to the range of differences that describes, you know, the composition of different groups of people in the world in a cross-cultural and multinational context. We can say global diversity helps us to work and communicate more effectively across cultures. That's why to build a real understanding of global diversity, I think it's vital for people worldwide to first make the attempt to connect, which is what we're both doing right now.
Absolutely.
Yes. And secondly, they will need to identify and acknowledge how they can positively impact on each other's community. What can we benefit from each other? And I think thirdly, they will need to truly celebrate their cooperation and collaboration by ensuring that they achieve genuine unity of purpose in their diversity. And the principal motives of their connection should be to share knowledge, culture, and beliefs in such a way that the world can start to explore the beauty in its diversity. And interestingly, education is the best platform for this, since education itself is basically a process of enlightenment. Nothing, in my opinion, can better enlighten our world than for us to all envision a shared and inclusive future for all. I once read a book by an author, Michael Fullan, who is a former global authority on educational reform, as you know. Yeah. And in his book, The Six Secrets of Change, the number two secret, I believe he said, is for us to connect peers with purpose. You know, people to connect with purpose. Indeed, in today's complex and diverse world, we need to start connecting peers with purpose all over the globe.
Absolutely, and it's been extraordinary to see the kind of development of those sort of platforms, the possibilities that we've had, that we've perhaps until the last 2 years not used quite as effectively as we've started to do. As a result of the pandemic, extraordinary how we've been creative in our use of connections and podcasts, webinars, networks, yes, with one another that have developed over that time. But I love the way that you're talking there about diversity being something which we embrace and celebrate rather than perhaps fearing, which is a really important way of looking at why we want inclusion and so that purposeful yes, element that you bring out through Michael Fullan's quote there, I think is really important, connecting with purpose. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. There needs to be a purpose behind that connection, the reason why, and that understanding, it makes people feel more relaxed and more willing to share their knowledge, their skills, their culture, their beliefs, and in a respectful way that everybody and around them cherish, you know, what they have to offer.
Mm-hmm. So what advice would you give educators on global diversity?
Yes, I think in general, educators should endeavor to keep themselves continually informed about global trends in education and best practices. And I think the next thing will be for them to innovate creative ways by which the global community can remain connected on a platform of educational instructions. And the dissemination and sharing of knowledge, this is critical, you know, because we don't know everything. We don't know everything about people's culture. We don't know everything about people's background. You asked me a critical question at the start of this conversation. You said, teach me how to pronounce your name, you know, and I went into it. Not only was I, you know, telling you or teaching you how to pronounce my name, I also reflected on the meaning of, you know, that name or how it is actually pronounced. So that's great. And I think thankfully a lot of educators are already, you know, doing this. They are connecting, they are finding ways to create that connection with everybody. And, you know, it's famously said that it takes a village to raise a child. Nothing better underscores the needs for global diversity than the fact that the world is actually a global village, our global diversity village. And I believe that should comprise of small groups of educators from different parts of the world, focusing on different aspects of global diversity in education, such as, you know, in such areas that would necessarily include curriculum, sports, competitions, and even donations towards the pulling together of educational resources in some places. I think the world's educators should also adopt global diversity as a way of transforming the lives of others, especially those who live in the fringes of modern society in the remote areas of the world where, you know, access to educational resources is not readily available to them. Mm-hmm. Could be technology or could even be books. And I also think that policymakers can also create diversity awareness in schools by enacting policies that encourage the recruitment of instructors and educators from other parts of the world and encourage cultural sensitivity within school communities, such that staff and students can gain a deeper understanding of people from diverse backgrounds.
These are such important areas. I feel as if I could talk to you for hours about these. we're limiting our time today, but these are things that we need to expand upon, because the whole area of diverse recruitment and how we sustain ever-growing and ever-richer understanding of various different cultures is so important. That you've brought out so many points there. Wonderful. I'm going to ask you now about, you know, our focus in schools is on teaching and improving student learning the whole time. And
absolutely.
So let's come to the students, because they're what we're all about. How might students lead change in building deeper understandings that lead to action?
Yes, our students are amazing at sharing their thoughts, their ideas, how they envision things, how they'll like things to work, and how they would like their learning environment to be organized in a way that helps them immerse themselves into the learning that's going on in the environment. And you can see this as early as, you know, when they're 3 year olds in nursery, or 4 year olds in a reception class. You see how we nurture them, and they define the environments, they rearrange things, they rearrange the entire classroom sometimes, and they tell you, Miss, we want to put it this way, we decided to build this, or we decided to do that, and we follow their interest, and we make sure we create an environment that's inclusive of their ideas and their imagination, you know. I think, you know, the International Student Exchange Program, for example, have been popular for decades, but at the moment, you know, it may have suffered a slight setback due to the global COVID travel restrictions. However, technology can come into the rescue, and it has been coming to the rescue in the past few years by fostering a global diversity support platform for students. And we see this everywhere. And I think we as educators should continue to exert all efforts to sustain cross-national cooperation in the education sector. And as educational providers, we need to provide opportunities in the form of various international programs that considers ethnic, linguistic, cultural, gender, and religious diversity as some of the strategies that can be used to continue to unify our diverse world. We start with this in schools by selecting student councils, and the students act as ambassadors for their schools. They attend competitions and along with other students, and they gather the voices of other students to share with the leadership team. That gives us an idea of how they see their education. I know in Qatar, we had students who participated in the Qatar eNature contest, which was a contest that an organization that is aimed to raise environmental awareness among students. And that's also done in collaboration with the Ministry of Education, you know, who are the policymakers. We've also seen students participate in the Model United Nations programs. We've seen students participate in the Duke of Edinburgh Awards program. The list goes on and on. And the more we involve students in these programs, they lead the change. They communicate that change to other students worldwide. And we see actions from there as well. You know, the e-nature context, how do you provide your protect your environment and understand, you know, the do's and don'ts to ensure that sustainability of whatever infrastructures and nature in general.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful, thank you so much. I kind of see your vision for where we're going with student leadership and also ownership of our learning as children, as young people, through your vision there for students at the centre of action and change. Dr. Lola Wright Odusoga, Sugar. Thank you so very, very much for your time today and for your constant involvement in the work that we do at ECIS. We're very grateful to you and thank you very much for our conversation today.
Thank you so much, Sarah. It's been wonderful to have the opportunity to share my insights on these topics and to continue to learn from other people on the platform as well who come on ECIS and to share their vast ideas and knowledge and skills on so many different topics. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Well, bless you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye now.
Well, we very much hope that you have enjoyed this latest edition of ECIS Talks. Don't forget, if you want to find out more information about all of the events that are coming up over the next few months, just visit ecis.org/events. Also, if you're interested in coming to our ECIS Leadership Conference this April in St. Albans, please apply as soon as possible for your tickets because we only have a few left. 2 weeks later, we do have a virtual conference and you can learn more information about this via the events page or you can visit ecis.org/leadership2022. Thanks very much for now, and we'll see you soon.